And I gave him a smartphone, and boom, he's online. He uses Google Maps, he uses Gmail, Facebook, everything, right? So most of the Indians, unlike West and China, they have never accessed internet on a desktop or a laptop. And that was pretty fascinating. And 4 years ago, 6 years ago, smartphones used to be this small, 3-inch, 4-inch. And we didn't have a mobile site or a mobile app. So people were accessing our desktop site on a small little device. And that basically made me think that smartphone is what is changing the world. And one thing led to another. I knew Xiaomi founders. And a few months down the line, I was starting Xiaomi's business in India. So that's a brief introduction about me. I hope the PPT is ready now. Is it? Okay, no, still no. Okay, let me ask you guys, do you know how to pronounce the name of a company?
Xiaomi.
Any other pronunciation that you know?
Xiaomi,
okay. Okay, so I'm pretty impressed because most of you guys said it correctly, which of course is shows that all of you guys are very smart, very active on internet. So the company next is called as Xiaomi. It's not called as Xiaomi. It's not called as Xiaomi. It's definitely not called as Gioni, right? So it's called as Xiaomi. The easiest way to remember this is just remember, show me the money and make it small. So what is it called? What is it called? Yes. We have a logo. What is our logo? It's there behind your phones. Okay. What does MI stand for? Any other meaning?
Mission Impossible.
Okay. What else?
Mobile Internet.
Mobile Internet. Okay. I really like Mission Impossible. But unfortunately, that is not the meaning of our logo. The meaning of our logo is Mobile Internet. The reason is when the company started 8 years ago, the aim of the company or the vision of the company was to change the way mobile internet is consumed, right? It's a very different philosophy, and that's why we believe we are a much more than a smartphone company. We have multiple businesses. While most of the people think we are a smartphone company, we're of course a smartphone company, but we have our own operating system. So we are a little bit like operating system companies like Google and Facebook. We are of course a hardware company making smartphones. We are also an IoT company. We have smart scooter, smart cycle, smart TV, smart shoes, fitness band, a bunch of other smart lights, and bunch of other IoT devices. In fact, we are the world's largest IoT platform. If you exclude smartphones, the most number of IoT devices, connected IoT devices, are from Xiaomi across the world. We are also an e-commerce company, just like Flipkart or Amazon or Alibaba. We have our own e-commerce platform called as me.com, mi.com, not me. mi.com, mi.com, and it's the eighth largest e-commerce platform in the world, third largest in India, third largest in China, and we'll talk more about this in the PPT. So the way to think about Xiaomi's business model is it's a pretty unique business model. We have software, OS, we have hardware, smartphones, we have IoT, smart TV, smart scooter, smart cycle, and we have e-commerce, me.com. And a combination of all four of these things is what makes Xiaomi very unique. We believe we have a very unique philosophy as compared to any other smartphone brand or any other technology company in the world. Finally, we have the document ready. This is a 24-hour-old document. This is the one that was sent to the team yesterday. I had made some changes, but it's okay. We'll use the same one. And I'll probably use, say, verbally, whatever changes we had made.
Okay.
Yeah, oh, okay, awesome. Finally, it's working, okay. So this, I've already introduced myself. So let's quickly jump into Xiaomi. So I've already explained how to pronounce the name of Xiaomi, right? Can you guys see the slide? Okay, do you want us to switch out the lights?
No.
Okay. So the company name is Xiaomi. Our logo is MI, which basically means mobile internet. When the company started, our vision was innovation for everyone, which means we want to build really innovative, cool technology, and we want to make it affordable so that everybody can enjoy technology. Our aim is, or our vision is, that technology should not be limited to only classes. Like, there are phones, there are TVs, there are like few lakh rupees, and then only few select people can really afford it. And our aim is, how do we bring the same technology or even a better technology than that at a much lower price point. Whenever we launch a product, these are the three simple philosophies that we use. The product has to be really innovative, with best possible specs. It has to be of highest quality and honest price. Honest price doesn't mean the cheapest possible price. The honest price means that we try and cut down all possible costs, like marketing, like distribution, and then we give the product almost at cost to the consumer, and that's what we call as honest price. Started only about 8 years ago, so we are a young startup, started in 2010. We are younger than Flipkart, we are younger than many other startups here in the country. And in just 8 years, we have become the fourth largest smartphone maker in the world and the biggest IoT platform in the world. We are the fastest growing tech company in the history of mankind. We were the fastest to cross $1 billion revenue mark within 2 years of starting the company, fastest to cross $10 billion revenue mark within 4 years of starting the company, and fastest to cross $15 billion revenue mark, which was last year in the seventh year of company's existence. This is the time taken by different companies to cross $15 billion revenue mark. Google took 9 years, Facebook 12 years, Alibaba and Tencent 17 years, and Apple 20 years. And Xiaomi took only 7 years. Okay. Thank you. These are all the companies and their growth rate last year, 2017 over 2016. And if you look at, something wrong with the slide. But the point was, if you look at most of the tech companies, and these are all the tech companies, I don't know why their names are not visible. But if you look at most of the tech companies, they've grown, some of the best ones, they grew about like from anywhere between 20 to 50% year on year. And Xiaomi grew at about 67% from 2016 to 2017. We are the fastest growing tech company in the world today. And if you leave aside tech and internet and include all of the companies, including like construction, hospitality, et cetera, then we would be the second fastest growing company in the world. We have a pretty unique philosophy, which is related to our honest price, which is we will never ever make more than 5% profit margin on any hardware product. So first of all, we cut down all possible costs, like distribution, marketing, working capital, inventory, and then we do not make more than 5% profit margin. And we hope, really hope, to make money from our internet services, from our operating system, rather than making money from our hardware. Most of the companies in the world, they will have a minimum cap. So their board will say, you can never make less than 20% profit margin, or you can't make more than, or you cannot make less than 30% profit margin. We are probably the only company which is saying you cannot make more than 5% profit margin. So pretty unique philosophy. We went public just about 2 months ago. These are different execs of company, different co-founders and other executives on the stage. We are now a public listed company in Hong Kong. This is me and our head of business here in India, Raghu, during this IPO ceremony. This was the third largest tech IPO in the history of mankind. Do you know which are the other two ones which are bigger than Xiaomi? Facebook. Sorry? Microsoft, no. Alibaba, yes. If you look at Microsoft, if you look at Google, if you look at many of these Apple, many of these tech companies, of course, they are much bigger than Xiaomi today. But when they went public, they were much smaller than Xiaomi today. The two companies which are bigger than Xiaomi when they went public were Alibaba and Facebook. And if you look at last 4 years since Alibaba went public, this is the largest tech IPO. Today, we are the fourth largest smartphone maker in the world, number one being Samsung, Apple, Huawei, and then Xiaomi, and probably the fastest growing smartphone maker, growing almost at 100% year on year. We have been rated as one of the most innovative companies in the world. This is a ranking by MIT. They came up with a ranking. We had pretty tough competition. If you look at this list, you have companies like Facebook on number 29, Uber on 50, Google on 12, Amazon on 13, and Xiaomi was rated as the second most innovative company in the world. Of course, number one was Tesla. And it's pretty tough to beat Tesla, with all due respect, like Tesla is incredible, but yeah, pretty happy to be up there as the second most innovative company in the world. This is the model that I was explaining a little bit earlier, that while people think we're a smartphone company, we're much more than a smartphone company. 8 years ago when company started, the first product that we built was MIUI, the one that you see on the left-hand side, which is our internet platform. We build our own operating system, a lot of other internet products. We build Mi Finance, Mi Music, Mi Video, Mi Movies, a lot of internet products and services. And then we started building smartphone as a vehicle to deliver these internet services. And then we built many other IoT products, like smart TV, smart shoes, smart cycle, etc. And then we built Mi.com so that people can come and buy these internet products or smart products through our e-commerce platform. We are probably the only company which is doing all of these three things, software, hardware, and e-commerce together. These are the different kind of internet IoT devices that we have. We have scooters, drones, laptops. Many of these things are not even legally allowed in India, for example, drone. But the hope is, over a period of next few years, we'll bring a lot of these cool IoT devices to India. So a little bit about our journey in India. While the company is 8 years old, in India, we are just about 4 years old, started 4 years ago. And one of the first things which happened was this man invested in Xiaomi when we started, right? Do you know him? Yeah. So Mr. Tata is an investor in Xiaomi and continues to be a mentor to Xiaomi India. Extremely thankful to him for supporting us, for being part of this journey. This is how our journey started. From one small room, almost as small as the cabin behind you guys, one small room here in Bangalore. The first room that we had could only seat about six people. And for the first 2-3 months, there was nobody else in the team except for me. And sometimes it used to be pretty lonely, and it used to be very weird, because I used to have meetings with potential partners. I used to call them to our office, and then I used to open the door of the office. Myself used to serve tea and coffee. And they used to feel very weird, because some of these deals were like worth maybe like a few hundred crores. And they used to feel very weird that this is the same guy who's serving tea and coffee, opening the door, and the same guy who's talking about a few hundred crores deal. And they used to ask me this question, like, so if you are the India head, who is, like, where is your team? And my usual joke with them used to be, I'm the head, I'm the tail, I'm everybody, right? And then this guy joined, he was our employee number one. And I felt really good after almost like 3 months, because finally I had somebody to talk to. Like, it was no longer a very lonely experience going to office, because somebody is there, you can actually talk to that person, have discussion, or discuss your problems. That's how our journey started. Today we are more than 600 employees across country. We have 4 different offices. Main office in Bangalore, Delhi, Mumbai, Kolkata. And if you look at everything that we have done, there are more than 15,000 people working for Xiaomi. 600 are our own employees, another 14,500 people who are working dedicatedly for Xiaomi. This was the first product that we launched, Mi 3. Anybody who bought this phone ever? Mi 3? Oh, wow. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 people in this room basically bought Mi 3. Oh, 7. Seven. Oh, are you using Mi 3? No, Note 3, okay. Mi 3 was the first product that we launched. It was an incredible device. When we were launching this product, I went to a lot of people, and I asked these industry experts, including some of the ex-CEOs or then-CEOs of different tech companies, smartphone companies, people whom I knew. And I said, we are about to launch this product. Give me some advice. Like, how do you sell smartphones? And I'd never sold smartphones in my life. The only experience that I had was that my wife used to work. She's here. She used to, at some point of time, she used to work at Nokia. So she used to sell smartphones then. So somebody in the family has to sell smartphones, right? So I went to her, I went to a few other people and asked, like, how do you sell smartphone? And the usual advice that I got from a lot of experts, including many of these CEOs, was you're doing it wrong. You should not, like, the entire philosophy of Xiaomi is wrong. Because you're trying to sell online while the entire industry is offline. And you're trying to spend zero marketing dollars and sell a product, why should somebody come and buy a Xiaomi product? Nobody will come. It's a difficult name to pronounce. Nobody knows that you exist. Nobody knows about this product. And this will never work. Some of the people even said that if you do this, within a few months, you will shut down your shop and go back. You will never succeed. So I was pretty scared. I really thought at many times during those first few months, that maybe I'm making a mistake, maybe company is making a mistake, and maybe everybody else, including all these CEOs, they are right that we might not succeed. So we were very conservative. The first sale of Mi 3, we brought in only 10,000 units. Now, why 10,000? Any guesses? Why not like 20? Why not 5? Why not 50?
You wanted to test the market.
You wanted to create hype. Okay? You want to test the market. Hype, no. Test the markets, yes. But the reason why we brought 10,000 phones was because we could have tested the market with also 5 or 20, right? The reason why we brought in 10,000 units was we went to a Facebook page and we saw there were 10,000 people following us on a Facebook page. Okay? So we said, at least 10,000 people in this country know about Xiaomi. At least 10,000. So let's bring in 10,000 phones. And the only hope in our life was to sell these 10,000 units. And we thought if we can sell these 10,000 units, we would be a big success. The first sale day was 22nd July 2014 on Flipkart. That's when we launched. That's where we launched. And this is what happened. Flipkart crashed for the first time in the history of Flipkart. Half a million people, 5 lakh people, turned up to buy this product, and including 6 people in this room, right? And it was crazy. Like, this was way beyond what Flipkart had ever expected. Of course, today, if you ask half a million number to Flipkart, it's a very small number. But 4 years ago, it was a pretty big number. They had never seen a peak traffic of half a million people coming at the same time and trying to buy one single product, which was Mi 3. Flipkart actually had to put up this tweet. And we still make fun of Flipkart that we crashed you guys, right? So this is what happened. And then we started building our business. We said we're on to something good, something very positive, right? So we started building our business. For last 4 quarters, we have been the number one smartphone brand in the country. Started in Q3 till about Q2 this year. This is how we grew. So that quarter, when Q3, when we launched, we sold about 1 lakh units, 10,000 every week for about 10 weeks. By our first anniversary, we were selling 1 million a quarter. By our second anniversary, we were selling 3 million a quarter, which is Q3 2016. And Q3 2017, when we became the number one smartphone brand, for the first time, we crossed 9 million a quarter. Okay. So a company whose obituary was written even before we started, this is how we have grown over the last 4 years, right? Today, we're the number one smartphone brand. We have about 30% market share in the country, which means if there are 3 phones sold in India, 1 out of 3 phones approximately are Xiaomi phones, right? Number one is Xiaomi, number two, Samsung, number three, Vivo, number four, Oppo, and then everybody else. We started selling online, and if you look at just the online segment, we are a much more dominating brand. We have more than 50% market share within the online segment. So we are bigger than everybody else put together in the online segment. And we are almost 6 to 7x bigger than the second and third biggest brands within the online segment. We are also number one, not just in phones, but in many other categories, for example, wearables. We have about 50% market share in the country, which is Mi Band. How many people using Mi Band? Oh, few, at least 10, 15 people, okay? And we're also number one or leading brand in after-sales service. So this is a report which is published by Red Quanta, and they look at multiple parameters like quality of service, timeliness of service, number of service centers, courtesiness of staff, and they come up with one cumulative score. And last year, we were number three in this report. This year, we became actually number one. So not only number one in sales, but also number one in after-sales. Mi.com, our e-commerce platform, today is the third largest e-commerce platform in the country. Of course, we are smaller than Flipkart and Amazon, but they're also, they spend a lot of money on buying traffic, on advertising, and they have a large number of SKUs. And we only sell our own products on Mi.com, and yet we are the third largest e-commerce platform in the country. Offline, for the first 3 years, till about mid of last year, we were mainly selling online. And everybody thought, including us, by the way, that maybe we will not be able to succeed in offline. And it was a tough challenge because traditionally the company had only sold products in the online segment. We had our own e-commerce platform. We were working with Flipkart and Amazon. And we thought maybe we can never succeed in offline because offline is a very different beast. And our market share till about beginning of or middle of last year in offline used to be less than 0.5%. So we started by opening a Mi Home store, which is our own flagship store. This is how it looks like, the first Mi Home store that we opened. This is in Phoenix Market City in Bangalore. The first time that we were opening this store, we went to this mall, Phoenix Mall, and we asked the mall developer, can you give us a store in the ground floor? He said no. There were stores available on ground floor, and he still said no. He said, why? Because you're an online brand. You have 50% market share in online, but nobody will come and buy your product in offline. And I don't want to waste my premium real estate on ground floor on a brand like you. He said, okay. Yeah, beggars can't be choosers. Yeah. So what can you give to us? He said, I'll give you lower ground floor, basement. We said, okay, we'll take it. We really wanted to be in this mall for whatever reason. So we decided finally to take up that location. This was the first store that we opened. And the mall developer told us, if 100 people turn up on your store on first day, you should consider it a big success. 100 people in one store in one day. This is what happened. The first day, 10,000 people turned up. There were people coming from UP, people coming from Odisha, people coming from Maharashtra. Somebody took a train from UP, traveled for 36 hours to come for this store inauguration. There was a gentleman from Gujarat who carried a bag full of cash because he wanted to buy phones for everybody in his family and his village. And it was almost like a security threat for us because like a bag full of cash. And it was incredible. One day, 10,000 people, and this was the biggest ever queue that Phoenix Mall had ever seen. One day, we did a revenue of 5 crore rupees in just one single shop, 5 crores. The funny story is, after this store got inaugurated, the CEO of Phoenix Mall called us and asked us or requested us, can we open a Mi Home in every single Phoenix Mall across the country? Of course, we are opening it. But then we renegotiated all the terms. He said, we need premium real estate, lower rental, and no revenue sharing. Of course, I can't share details, but it was pretty interesting, that conversation. We also started opening our Mi Preferred Partner stores. And in just 1 year, from less than 0.5% market share, we have grown to more than 20% market share in offline. So in online, we have 55% market share. In offline, we used to be almost zero. Now we have 20% market share. And combined, we have 30% market share, online, offline. We are present in only about 40 cities. But out of 40 cities, in about 10 cities, only in offline, we have become number one in these 10 cities. For example, if you look at Chandigarh, only in the offline market of Chandigarh, we would have 43% market share. And if you include online, then our market share in Chandigarh would be about 60%. So now we are trying to see how can we expand from these 40 cities in offline to about 100, 150 cities. This again stopped working. Okay. Yeah. Today, if you look at India, last year the top three selling phones in India were all Xiaomi phones. If you look at this year, top four selling phones in India are all Xiaomi phones. Number one, number two, number three, and number four. We also launched TV. Anybody who has bought a TV, Xiaomi TV here. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay, 10 people, okay. Do try this out. I'll talk more about this TV later on. It's an incredible piece of TV. And we've already become the number one or the leading brand in online segment. In about few months, 6 months, we sold about 5 lakh units. Of course, this is nowhere comparable to the phone sale, but it must be some sort of a record even in the TV segment. I'll skip this one. I'll talk a little bit about our manufacturing. This is something that we are really passionate about. 3 years ago, August 2015, we launched our first manufacturing plant in India. And this is even before government had announced any tax benefits for producing phones in the country. Our philosophy was very simple. We wanted to be closer to consumers. We wanted to build products in India for India. And we wanted to cut down on working capital cost, which was an important thing for us. Cut down on inventory cost. When you import from other countries, the lead time is much longer. So we said, can we start making phones in India? We made a very interesting gentleman in India. Do you know him? We met him a few times to discuss our Make in India plans. This is when our CEO chairman, Lejun, was here. We got a chance to spend about an hour with him to discuss our Make in India plans. He gave us some really nice suggestions on what else can we do better. So coming back to Make in India, we have 6 plants across the country, across 3 different campuses in 3 different states. Almost all our phones that we sell in India are now made in India. And every single second, we can make 2 phones. Every second, 2 phones. We started manufacturing PCBs in the country. And across these 6 factories, we have more than 10,000 employees. And what makes me really proud is the fact that if you look at these 10,000, 12,000 employees that we have, almost all of them, more than 95% of them, are women. This is a new factory that we announced. I'll skip this one. Service. We believe this is a pretty important part of our business. So we have 1,000 service centers across the country. This was a 1,000 service center that we opened. Today, almost all our cases, more than 95% of our cases, complaints that we get, we can resolve within 4 hours, and about 85% within 2 hours. This is a chart that I showed earlier, number one also in after-sale service. I'll skip some of these slides. Okay, so I'll move on to this one. Now, for the first 3 years, in 2014, 15, 16, until about 17 mid, we spent almost zero marketing dollars, right? Of course, end of last year when we started building our offline business, we started spending a little bit of marketing dollars, right? Some TV ads, some outdoor hoardings. But it was incredible. For the first 3 years, till the time we became the number one smartphone brand, we had spent literally zero marketing dollars. It must be some sort of a case study. And then people used to ask this when I used to go and meet people, investors or other CEOs, and I used to tell them that we have become the number one smartphone brand. People used to never believe me because they used to say, how is it possible? I've never seen your TV ad. I've never seen your print ad. How come you have become the number one smartphone brand? So we, of course, do marketing, but we just don't do advertising. And that's what we believe, that you can actually do phenomenal marketing even without advertising. So what is Xiaomi's way of marketing? This is my favorite 2x2. Anybody wants to go to consulting? People want to go to consulting. When you join a consulting firm, this will be a favorite framework that they will teach you, right? A 2x2, right? Which is basically just draw 2 axes and high, low, right? So on one side, I have marketing spend, and on the other side, we have product innovation, low and high. And if you look at most of the traditional companies, like FMCG companies, like automobile companies, they typically were on that side of quadrant. Very little product innovation. You will launch a new soap, very little differentiation from the old soap, but what will you do? You'll spend a lot of marketing dollars, right? Give it a new cool name, launch, hire a new celebrity, do a lot of TV ads, and sell that soap, right? Or same with automobiles, same with cars, a lot of other stuff, right? And if you look at most of the new-age tech companies or internet companies, they're on extreme other end, on the top left side, which is product innovation. Companies like Google, Facebook, Tesla, and many other. Have you seen any of these companies really spend money on marketing? Very little, right? Or almost negligible. Like, Google didn't become Google by spending a lot of marketing dollars on TV and saying, hey, you should come and use my search. Or Facebook didn't become Facebook by spending a lot of marketing dollars and saying, you should come and use Facebook or WhatsApp, right? Same for Tesla and same for WhatsApp. And these are the companies that succeeded because they had massive product innovation and almost zero or negligible marketing spends. And we believe we are in the same quadrant where we would like to innovate on product, on technology, and not really spend marketing dollars. This is how traditional advertising used to be. If you talk to any FMCG guy, any FMCG company, this is how they behave. When I was growing up in the 1990s, the only TV channel used to be Doordarshan. And then DD2 came, and then slowly and gradually cable came, right? And the way of marketing used to be, you put a TV ad, a pretty face, and then it's a one-to-one communication. Why do I say one? Because there's no way to take feedback. You just say, my soap is really good, some big movie star saying this, and people are bound to believe that, and people will go to the shop and buy that soap. While at Xiaomi, We believe that is not the right way of communicating. We believe there's an alternate way of communication, which is what we call as brand influencers or our me fans. People who are brand evangelists, people who really believe in brand, who are advocates of brand, people like you, who basically use our products, and then they go and tell it to their friends and family members, saying, you should probably buy a Xiaomi phone. Why? Because it's a really good phone at great specs, great price. And that way, we actually try and communicate with them so that we also take feedback from them. It's not a one-way communication. It's a two-way communication with these guys. As I said, we don't believe in advertising. We, of course, believe in marketing, but not advertising. And all our marketing is driven by one single thing, which is product. What are the four P's of marketing? Product, price, place, promotion, right? All of us are taught this in MBA schools, right? But I believe not all four P's are equally important. There's one P, which is probably 10 times, 20 times more important than the other three P's, which is product. If you get the product right, other three P's do not matter. Of course, they matter. Don't get me wrong. But not to the same extent, right? Even if you don't do any promotion, even if your placement is incorrect, you can still win if your product is really cool, right? I have a slide on this one. Right, product which is more important than any other things. So how do we build these brand evangelists, right? So we call them as me fans. These are people who are young, passionate. There's no enrollment process for becoming a me fan. Anybody can become a me fan. And these are the people who really love Xiaomi and spread positive word about Xiaomi amongst their social circles. We have a Mi community, our own official community app, and we have 15 million DAUs, which is 1.5 crore people who come and access Mi community every single month. Incredible, right? And we don't spend any marketing dollars on Mi community. Everything that we do, we celebrate with our fans. Like, we completed our 8 years, and during these 8 years when we completed, we celebrate across the world with our Mi fans, and they wrote like thousands of letters to us on why do they love Xiaomi. Today in India, we have 20 official Mi fan clubs across all major cities, including Bangalore, including Calcutta, and many other cities. And these Mi fans just meet there once in a month to talk more about technology, not just about Xiaomi, but also about technology in general. This was the first ever Mi fan meet. This is when the company just started. This was in Mumbai. And the guy who's sitting on the extreme, my left, your right, who's sitting over there, his name is Rohit. He was the first and probably one of the first few Mi fans in the country, and he had set up a Mi fan forum in the country, and then we hired him. He was also the employee number 3 in Xiaomi India. So this was the first ever fan meets, and every time we go to a city, we make it a point to do a fan meet over there, where we call people who are passionate about Xiaomi and just take feedback from them on how can we improve, what can we do better, what else suggestions will you have for our products. Like, this was a Mi fan meet in Mumbai. In our Mi community, we have 5 million registered users across the country now. We also organize large-scale events, which we call as Mi Pop events, where we call thousands of Mi fans from the country at one single place and celebrate with them in like a big gala song and dance kind of an event, which I don't think any other brand would do. We make them stay in really nice places. We don't spend any money on TV or on film stars. But we do actually spend a lot of money on events like this, which is to bond with our Mi fans. So coming back to product, so our entire marketing is driven by two things, Mi fans and products, community and products. So first thing, we spoke about all these Mi fans, and the second thing is all about products for us, marketing. So as I said, our core values when defining a product is best specs, best quality, and honest price, right? So let's talk about some of the products that we have recently launched. Now, this is a phone that we launched a few weeks ago called as Poco F1. It's a new sub-brand that we launched. Now, the incredible thing about this product is, if you look at flagship phones, like Snapdragon 800 series, most of these kind of products in India are priced, except for maybe OnePlus, which is priced at 35,000, most of these products would be priced at about 50,000-60,000 rupees. And then we decided to launch a flagship phone, which is better in specs than any of the other flagships in the country, at a really incredible price, which is 21,000 rupees. Here we have comparison with OnePlus 6, S9, and iPhone 10, and of course, all of them are much more expensive. While coming here, I was reading an EMI, reading a tweet, which basically said the new iPhone, which has been launched, if you look at the EMI of that phone, if you buy it on 6 months, it will be 20,000 plus, right? And the guy, it's a blogger, a journalist, who was making fun of it, saying, either you can go to MI or you can go to EMI, right? Right? Yeah. So all these flagships, anywhere between like 40 to 50 or 1 lakh rupees, and we basically launch a flagship phone with same or better specs at like 20, if you look at the flagship, it's starting at 21,000, but the highest end, which is 8 GB, 256 GB, is at 29,000 rupees, right? We also launched this TV. This is the world's slimmest TV, officially the world's slimmest LED TV. This is a real picture, not something which has been photoshopped. If you see from the side, it is basically as slim as a line, as thin as a coin, right? It will be thinner than any of your smartphones that you're holding or keeping in your pocket. This comes with a Dolby Atmos audio system, 500,000 hours or 5 lakh hours of content inbuilt into this, and officially the world's thinnest or slimmest LED TV, only at 45,000. Now, if you compare it with others, like Sony and others, the slimmest Sony TV is about 9 mm, sells for 3 lakh rupees, and the one here is about 2 lakh rupees, and we launch it at 45,000 rupees, right? So this is some of the things that we have been doing. Let me just pause here and maybe just share one last piece of advice for many of you guys, which has helped me, right? If you look at either my personal journey or even Xiaomi's journey, right? I think one of the key things that I've taken away is that we have, the reason why Xiaomi is successful is because we've always tried to do things differently from what others did. There were a lot of really good brands in India, very strong brands in India, smartphone, in IoT space and many other spaces. But the reason why we succeeded was because we did not follow what others were doing. Everybody else was going offline, and we were going online. Everybody was spending hundreds of crores in marketing, and we decided to spend $0 in marketing, right? So we chalked out our own path that we thought was right. Even if you look at my journey, everybody thought I was making a mistake by not applying to those 300 companies that came to IIM Calcutta, and I just applied in 3 companies. Or people thought I was making a big mistake by leaving my well-settled job at McKinsey to start Jabong, and which was a big risk at that point of time. So the only thing that I would say is, whenever you are thinking about your career, my only piece of advice to most of you guys, or all of you guys, would be, just don't do anything because somebody else is doing, or because that seems to be a fashion or a fad. Do what you think is right, and what you think will suit you. We at Xiaomi believe that e-commerce internet selling will suit us, while everybody else worked on offline. It worked beautifully well for us. It may not work for everybody else. So do what you are passionate about, what you believe in, and not just because your parents or your neighbors or your friends and family members are doing it, okay? Cool, thank you so much, guys, thank you. I'm here for some more time, so if you want to ask any questions, any suggestions, any doubts, feedback on our product, sir. Yeah, please. Okay. I'm just taking my water.
I've been an MI user since 2015, and I got Redmi 2 Prime. It was the first phone that was launched under the main India,
yes.
The first manufacturer.
Yeah.
So, sir, when I waited for this long to buy an MI phone, because I wanted to see what people have their outlook on. Because when we think about Chinese products, so there's a particular kind of a hype that those products are not that quality. So,
sure.
Yeah. So I waited then, and then eventually I saw that the youngsters were usually going for the MI phones. But the middle aged and the old crowd, they were not still into it. They were still very conscious about the China thing.
Yeah.
And eventually I have noticed that journey where, just as you said, that it has grown. So how much has Make in India contributed in your journey?
Oh, massive.
So how much has it contributed? And just now when I look around, people at every age group are very enthusiastically using the phone. So please just comment on the entire procedure of the evolution from a Chinese brand to the one that people feel so connected.
Okay. So I'll split it into 2 parts. One is Make in India. Second is the journey of people changing their perception about the Chinese brand, right? So first of all, has Make in India helped us massively? Not just because of Make in India sentiment. Of course, I think thanks to the Modi government, Make in India, they've made Make in India very cool in sexy, which is a good thing, right? We should be passionate about it. Like, we should be passionate about products which are being built here in the country, right? So, of course, I think that has helped us. But more than that, Make in India has also helped us because it has reduced the working capital cost. It has reduced the inventory in the system. When you import goods from China or Taiwan or anywhere else, from Korea or from Japan, what happens is you have to give a lead time of 3 to 4 weeks. Because first of all, you will order something, they will produce, they will ship it. Not every time you can ship everything through airplanes. The cost of shipping everything through airplanes is very high. So you have to bring it through ships, and ships will take their own sweet time. Plus, you have a, sometimes something will get cost, something will get stuck in customs, something will happen. A lot of things can go wrong, right? So when you move to Make in India, actually, we saw a huge saving across the board. And that basically helped us achieve even better pricing for our Mi fans, even reach a higher goal of making technology affordable. So has Made in India helped us massively? To answer your second question, that is right. I think 10 years ago, a lot of brands which came from China, these were the brands which basically stood for low quality, low price. And hence the perception about most of the Chinese companies and brands was Chinese are the chalegani, right? So it would be low quality, will not basically long last. And I think for us, it took us a little bit of time to educate customers that we are all about three things, right? About specs, quality, and honest price. And for us, it is even a higher pressure of ensuring that our quality standards are very high. I skipped some of those slides on quality. But we actually take immense pride in the fact that our products are of our highest quality. We measure something called as FFR, field failure rate. And we see our field failure rate is probably the lowest in the industry, which means our products are of highest quality, like least number of repairs are required on any of our phones. And now, when our products are of high quality, if you buy a phone, you will go and tell all your friends and family members, including your parents, saying, this is the phone that you should be buying because I've been using it. And that kind of marketing is 100 times more powerful than seeing some Khan's ad or some big cricketer's ad on TV, right? You don't realize, when you see a big movie star and then buy a product, you're not only paying for the TV ad that you're watching yourself, you're also paying for thousands of other people who are watching the TV ad and not buying that product, right? So you're actually paying for everybody because company will recover that money from somewhere, right? So our kind of marketing, which is mainly driven by word of mouth, is I think a lot more stronger than the traditional way of marketing. And the way it has changed for us is mainly through word of mouth. Like these young, passionate Mi fans are the ones, including people like you, who have helped spread word of mouth for us. Like I'm sure if you would have been a happy customer, you would have gone and told your father and your mother saying, hey, you should buy this phone because I know this, I have been using this.
Okay.
Let me first answer the first part of heating and blasting, right? Of course, do phones get heated up? Every single phone in this world will get heated up. This is like saying, when you switch on the car should not get heated up. Of course, if you touch the bonnet, or in the engine, it will be heated up. Now, the beauty of car manufacturing or car design is, how do you ensure that heat gets dissipated and you don't feel when you're sitting inside the car? Same beauty for us is, how do you ensure that the heat gets dissipated in the right way? First of all, can you reduce the heat? And whatever heat is there, how do you dissipate it within the phone? So we have done a lot of stuff. Now, when we started 4 years ago, of course, there was a problem because all our phones were designed for China. And in China, the average temperature is not as high as India, especially when you come to North India, like Delhi, or like Meerut, or UP, right? Where sometimes in summers, the temperature can be like 45, 46 degrees Celsius, right? The phone can really get heated up, right? So we did a lot of customization for all our India phones. Like all our phones basically come with a dual graphite sheet now, which helps reduce the temperature of the phone by a few degrees Celsius, right? Regarding the cases of blasting, right? If you guys are here or if you are talking to your friends and family members, I'll request each one of you to tell your friends and family members who are using Xiaomi phone or Mi phone that please, please, please do not open the phone, right? The usual mentality is because a lot of people have migrated from feature phones. When the phone gets hanged up or if phone is not working, let me just open the case, take out the battery, and then put it back. It will start working. That is not, any of the Xiaomi phones are not meant for that, at least the new generation ones. All our phones are unibody design, and the battery inside is stuck. It has been pasted using an adhesive to the body of the phone. So please do not open the phone. Even if you open the phone, for whatever reason, please do not take out the battery, because it is stuck to the body. If you try and forcibly take it off, it, this chemical inside, there could be any chemical reaction, anything could happen. So please do not do that. Like 99.9% of any of these cases which come are because of the same reason. So please do tell all your friends and family members, all of you guys, right? Please do not do that. Now, how have we been able to maintain this reason? Because these numbers are very little. And even if these numbers are there, they're basically of customer, like people usually acknowledge, or most of the people acknowledge that they tried doing something like this. For every such customer or complaint that you will see, if you go, even go to social media, you will see there are 100 other people who will, we do not do anything. They come and defend us, rather than we going and saying our products are of better quality.
All those products in India, do you fear that you won't be able to meet the demands?
Okay. Our China business is 8-year-old. So in China, we are 8-year-old company. In India, we're only 4-year-old. By the time we turn 8 years in India, I can assure you all the products will be here. just that our company is much smaller, team is much smaller, and our philosophy is less is good. Unlike many of the companies whose philosophy is more is good, our philosophy is less is good. What does it mean? Launch only 2 products. Other smartphone brands have like 30, 40 products launching every single year. We launch only 7 products in a year. But we ensure that each of these products is a blockbuster. Number 1, number 2, number 3, number 4 bestsellers in India are all Xiaomi products, right? So launch few, but do a good job. We have launched 8 categories. Out of these 8 categories, including one is smartphones, one is TV, one is fitness, one is air purifier, one is power banks. In 3, we are number 1 in India already. In another 4, we are number 1 in online, but not overall number 1 in India because we haven't launched them in offline. And there's only one category in which we are not number 1 in online, neither in online nor in offline. That category is fashion, our t-shirts, right? That is the only category, right? But if you give us a few more years, we will launch almost everything in India.
Sir, talking about China versus India, which country do you think is the best in terms of new product launch, marketing, market capturing, growth rate, and revenue?
Oh, a very tricky question. I don't think there's a simple answer to this. Both countries are very similar, and both countries are very different. Why are they similar? If you look at the socio-economic structure of each of these countries, they're very similar to each other. Like, if you look at till 90s, the per capita GDP, many other things were very similar. Of course, China has grown faster than India, and things are a little bit better, but even if you look at China, India is where China was 5 years behind ago, right? So very similar kind of cultural values, very similar kind of socioeconomic structure, right? But markets are very different, some markets. Like in India, 50% of phones, people who buy phones today, are still using feature phones. In China, that market is almost zero. In India, most of the people are buying their smartphone for the first time. In China, most of the people are migrating to the 4th or 5th smartphone. So it purely depends upon which market you're looking at. Let me talk about another market, which is two-wheelers. If you look at two-wheelers, India is a much bigger opportunity and much bigger market than China. Why? Because in China, most of the people have moved to cars. But because of income levels, because of road conditions and many other things, in India, still most of the consumers still prefer a two-wheeler over a four-wheeler. So it's a very tricky one. I don't think it's very simple to just say India is better than China or vice versa.
Sir.
There have been few cases, right? I'll be honest. But most of these were customer-induced. Like, and usually what happens is, anything negative which happens, people try and exaggerate it. I'll give an example. The first blast case that we heard, this was in Bangalore, in a particular shop, one of the partner shops, I'm forgetting the name, I think Purvik or Sangeeta, and some sort of a customer who had bought, his phone basically got blasted. Right? And then there was a video of some other shop in Kerala, of some other brand, which basically burned. And everybody said, oh, that's a Xiaomi phone which got blasted. And everybody started writing stories. It was covered in national newspapers, what are not national media, like TV channels, etc. And we were pretty surprised, saying that people are stupid enough to not even recognize the difference between Malayalam and Kannada, right? You are a journalist on a national TV, and you're basically taking the picture or a video of something being burned in a Kerala shop, where Kerala or Malayalam stuff is written in Malayalam. And we at that point of time, we were not even selling in Kerala, for whatever reason, right? Because e-commerce shipments were not allowed in Kerala, and we had not opened up our offline channels in Kerala. And TV channels were basically airing that. So it was pretty tough. We had to issue a public statement saying, yes, we found a case. We spoke to the customer. Customer agreed that he had opened the phone himself, and hence that's what caused the damage. And by the way, the video that these TV channels or whatever bloggers are showing is incorrect. It's from Kerala, not from Karnataka. And we also threatened them to take legal action against them. So all of them had to issue public apology and pull it back. So it's not easy, but... Offline. Okay.
And the other, so the second question is, are you guys focusing on online mode or offline mode?
Okay. Why did we go to offline? That's the question number one. 4 years ago, 2014, when we started, the share of online in Indian smartphone industry was less than 10%. By 2017, that share of online in Indian smartphone industry had grown to 35%, from less than 10 to 35. And within that 35, we already had 55, 60% market share. And then we saw this 35 getting stagnated. So offline was still 65, online was still 35. And it was a little bit of concerning thing for us, because we said, if online is stagnating at 35, and we already have 55, 60% market share in 35, within 35, this 55, 60 will not become 80. Let's be realistic, right? Because there's so many other brands. Even if you hold on to this 50, 55, 60% market share, it's a big achievement. So we said we also need to capture this remaining 65%. And if 55% of 35% want to buy Xiaomi phone, then I'm pretty sure at least 30% of those 65% would also want to buy Xiaomi phones. That was the simple math why we started offline. What was the second question? Or focusing on online or offline? Both. But of course, offline has been a bigger success story for us in last 1 year. If you look at the first 3 years, online was a main success story for us. If you look at last 1 year, offline has been a bigger success story. Okay, let me pick somebody from the back, sorry. Sir, yeah, yellow shirt, yeah. Okay, brand segregation, of course, yes. We want to have, at some point of time, we may choose to have multiple brands in India. It's a very common philosophy, or a strategy which is used by many, many companies across the world. If you look at, not just Huawei and Honor, but even if you look at automobiles, like Lexus and Toyota are two different brands from the same company, right? And why did Toyota create Lexus? Because at some point of time, they realize that they want to capture even the premium end of the market. And with Toyota brand, they might not be able to capture it, because Toyota is also mid-segment, right? So that's why they created Lexus. So for us, POCO is very similar. Thank you. Thank you. You can also follow me on Instagram. I believe I'm a young person, and all the young people are on Instagram. So that's why I'm on Instagram also.
So is this actually a planned strategy for you to, market
in LinkedIn, or is it? Okay. So we want to use social media very, very actively. Very simple reason. Think about this, like the world is moving digital. The world is moving towards social media. where are all of us spending time? On things like Twitter, LinkedIn, Instagram, Facebook, et cetera, right? WhatsApp. And we believe we're a new age internet company. So why should we spend time on TV and radio? Like, we should be spending time on these kind of channels. And what is the best way to take feedback from consumers than to be ourselves active on these social media channels? So we actually encourage all our team members to spend some time on social media so that they really learn what today's new age people are saying and what are they asking for. The beauty of what social media is, it's a two-way communication. You might have seen me responding for a lot of queries on social media, right, on LinkedIn. Why? Because people give us feedback, we listen to them, and we respond to them, right? That's a never-ending, evolving process. So you can follow us, me or our channels, across all platforms, Instagram, Twitter, LinkedIn, Facebook, wherever, right?